The eulogy will be delivered, so please come in.
She's not going to be reading your song book.
The eulogy has to be heard, so we are asking persons to please come in. Park or blab or la potla, as you view the body, please walk past and come and have a seat. Make yourself comfortable. Please come in and sit. Still seeing too many persons standing at the entrance. Please, people, cooperate. We are about to begin. Come and have a seat. We want to do all what's on the program before the priests come in. A pleasant good afternoon to you, brothers and sisters. We, the parishioners of the Holy Family Parish, along with our parish priest, Father Henry, Deacon Jeremy Joseph, and Deacon Evaristus, extend prayers of sympathy to the families and friends of our deceased sister. A special welcome to all as we come together today to pay our last tribute in honor of a daughter, a mother, a wife, and a dear friend. Thanks to those viewing us on live stream. We, the family, recognize your humble presence as we mourn and bid farewell. Psalms 103, verse 15 to 18. As for us, our life is like grass. We grow and flourish like a wild flower. Then the wind blows on it, and it is gone. No one sees it again. But for those who honor the Lord, his love lasts forever, and his goodness endures for all generations. of those who are true to his covenant and who faithfully obey his commands. Now we invite the person with the tribute. The person to deliver the tribute, please come up.
This was a tribute written by Natasha's kids, and it will be read by me, sorry. Our mother. For the few years that we were raised in Barbados, I can say that it was by a very St. Lucian woman. It was probably the funniest thing to witness her interactions with us. I think everyone knew my mother to be one with a permanent frown on her face, which would automatically disappear when she said something that actually made sense or had a piece of gossip. Mom hated it when you made nonsensical remarks. She would blatantly ignore us if we asked anything not very important. What we all found funny about Mom was when I got her to take in our cat Bella, which she was so against. Yet she named her, fed her, and raised her like she was her child. Mom may have treated Bella better than the three of us, if you ask me. Every day we'd come home from school, and Bella would be propped next to Mom's leg or on her while she was laid out on the couch, getting belly rubs or just breezing watching the Golden Girls. They would even go on adventures in the backyard. What made us question the two of them the most was the fact that sometimes it seems as if Mom could communicate with Bella, because the cat would ignore us and hiss at us, but would follow Mom everywhere she went, even in the bath. Bella was Mom's partner in crime, and if Bella was nowhere to be found, Nadal would be the next Bella. Sometimes I think that he was so glad to come home to find out that the cat wasn't in the house that day and would run to his mother, hug her, kiss her, and end up laying on her and watching Golden Girls. Even he would get little belly rubs as well. Even through her darkest days, she knew she would depend on us to fill her with laughs and love. There were days even when having us didn't really help as much, and we'd all just sit with her and hug her while she tried to sleep through the pain, or while she tried distracting herself by watching TikToks and laughing at cat memes. But what really helped ease her mind sometimes when we couldn't was writing. She carried a journal everywhere and jotted down her thoughts. Despite how grim they started, she would always end on a hopeful note. Above everything else, our mother was a person filled with love and hope. Mommy was always there for us, always welcoming, despite the scowl on her face that scared away a lot of people. These past few years have not been easy, and the recent weeks weren't any better. Mom suffered through many years with this pain, but we always tried to look at the positive side of it. We always kept reminding her that better times were coming, to stay strong and hold on for us. We tried to be there as much as possible. We tried to spend as much time with her as we could. We tried to stay strong for her and for each other, and so did she. It hurt us to see her in pain, but her laughs and the great times we spent together made us believe that everything would be okay. She has done so much for us, and it's hard to imagine anyone who can take her place. Who will love us like our mother. We lost our best friend, the person who showed us what it felt like to be loved. The lady who had our backs through thick and thin. The lady who could go out of her way to get something done for us. She believed in us. She believed in all our ambitious dreams and always told us to go ahead. She always told us to chase our dreams and never let anything deter us. This we will never forget. She was our role model. We aspire to be like her in so many ways. Her beauty, her bright personality, her loud laughs and snarky remarks. After Mom passed, while confiding in each other, we noticed that all three of us had most of these distinct traits. Sherik had her looks and her ambitions, Nadal her snarky remarks, and Nayana her personality and stubbornness. And we hope that when people look at the three of us, they see Nat. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone. Eulogy on behalf of the Williams family. We are here today to honor the memory of Cyrenia Williams-Seale, better known as Natasha of Marigot. This is a difficult task, not because I don't know what to say, but because there are so many wonderful things to share about her. Natasha had hopes of one day becoming an author and writing her memoir. Regrettably, she did not have the pleasure of seeing this dream come true. However, let this eulogy serve as her unofficial memoir. I am deeply thankful that I was entrusted with this task of documenting her life, and what better audience than us, those who knew and loved her dearly. On April 2nd, 1979, our African princess was born to Mary Dorisha Williams, better known as Afam, a force to be reckoned with and a natural-born trendsetter. She would change the very essence of the family dynamics. Being the youngest of five siblings, she was the baby of the family, and because she struggled to pronounce their names, she simply gave them new ones. Greta, the oldest, would become Uta. Jeanette, the second eldest, would become Tita. Cleaver would become Baba. Don was an easy one to pronounce, so she allowed him to keep his name. Every family member born after her would adopt those names, and to this day, their actual names are rarely ever used, not even by their own children. She called her mother Mummy, as most children do, and naturally, this is forever how she would be addressed. The family resided in Mondo in her early years and later settled in Marigot Bay, a picturesque community which would set the backdrop for her youth and early adulthood. She attended the Roseau Combined School and went to the Rock Hall Senior School and eventually at the Castries Comprehensive Secondary School. Growing up, Natasha had the kind of confidence which was very rare in a young girl coming of age in the 90s. She was often bullied for her very dark skin and would complain to her mother, who would advise her, in not so nice words, to stand up for herself. Well, our Natasha took this to heart, and she took great pride in insulting anyone who tried to make fun of her skin tone. This developed her confidence and pride in her complexion. For you see, Natasha was absolutely stunning. Her dark skin glowed and her smile could light up a room. She had the kind of rare beauty which was inspiring, and heads would turn everywhere she went. From an early age, she had a passion for fashion. She loved music, singing, performing, and aspired to become a model. In the mid-90s, she was a member of the local youth group in Marigot, and she participated in and won the Miss Marigot pageant. She went on to book multiple modeling gigs over the years with a crowning achievement, being photographed and featured in the National Geographic magazine in the early 2000s. And oh, how she loved to dance. She and her nieces, who were all in the same age group, by the way, Sandy, Olympia, their friends, Tina, Kiefer, Lynthia, Burnett, etc., loved nothing more than sneaking out to go to JJ's, the dance hall down the road. As they grew, they ventured further away. Anywhere there was a fete, they were there. From ancillary fish fry on a Friday night to the popular weekend community celebrations in Marigot, Cooley Town, Jackmel, Lakwade, you name it, they were there. Those days are surely missed. Despite being the life of the party, she also had the kind of demeanor and no-nonsense attitude which commanded respect. In the community of Marigot, everyone knew Nat to be someone you had to have big respect for, and some would even fear her. She was well known and loved within the community. Her close friends could attest to this. One distinct memory of Natasha is how she had a talent of affectionate insults, especially for Paula and Raspi. In 2001, she would have had her first child, Nayana, and from then on, she followed a new passion of motherhood. She was a loving and devoted mother who took great pride in raising her daughter. Nainai was the light of her life. She would later meet and fall in love with Dave Seeley, a Barbados native. Her little family of two grew to three, then four, then five, with the addition of the boys, Sharik and Nadelle. Those kids were her source of strength and motivation. Natasha and Dave moved to Barbados and got married in 2010. Living in Barbados would be quite the adventure. She would experience many highs and many lows, great joys and great pains, and would eventually be the place she would spend her last days. It was the place where she gave birth to her last born child. She raised her family and followed in her mom's footsteps to become an entrepreneur of two successful businesses, a plant nursery and a bar. Sadly, a few years ago, Nat fell ill. Even through her pain, she pushed and pulled on and put on a brave face. Our Nat never wanted us to see her in pain and tried her best to hide it. However, we worried for her. On June 26, she passed away at the Queen Elizabeth Hospital in Barbados. It is with dejected hearts that we must part ways with you, Nat. While we all gather here to say goodbye to you, we are also here to say hello to you in a new form. For you are in our hearts forever. Though your smile is gone forever and your hand we cannot touch, still we have so many memories of the one we loved so much. Your memory is our keepsake with which we will never part. God has you in his keeping. We have you in our hearts. It is sad to walk the road alone instead of side by side. But to all there comes a moment when the ways of life divide. You gave us years of happiness, then came sorrow and tears, but you left us beautiful memories we'll treasure through the years. We love you, our African princess. May you rest in perfect peace. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Family members, you may go back to the entrance whilst we await the priest. Family members, you may go back to the entrance.
service.
Amen.
Which St. Paul writes, in the day of Christ's coming,
together let us unite our voices as we join in singing, I will enter his gates. Stand for the opening prayer. Please stand.
Beloved brothers and sisters, we have come together to renew our trust in Christ, who by dying on the cross has freed us from eternal death, and by rising has opened for us the gates of heaven. Let us pray for our sister, that she may share in Christ's victory. And let us pray for ourselves, that the Lord may grant us the gift of a loving consolation. Let us pray. Almighty God and Father, it is our certain faith that your Son Jesus Christ died on the cross and was raised from the dead, the first fruits of all who are fallen asleep. Grant that through this mystery, your servant Cyrenia, who has gone to arrest Christ, may share in the joy of his resurrection. We ask this for our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. Amen.
We now invite our two readers up on the sanctuary.
A reading from the book of Job. Ah, would that these words of mine were written down, inscribed on some monument, with iron chisel and engraving tool, cut into the rock forever. This I know, that my avenger lives, and he, the last, will take his stand on earth. After my awakening, he will set me close to him, and from my flesh I shall look on God. He whom I shall see will take my part. These eyes will gaze on him and find him not aloof. The word of the God.
Thanks be to God.
In response, let us all join in singing. Sing out my soul to the Lord.
Thank you.
unite our voices.
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Romans. With God on our side, who can be against us? Since God did not spare his own son, but gave him up to benefit us all, we may be certain after such gift that he will not refuse anything he can give. Could anyone accuse those that God has chosen? When God acquits, could anyone condemn? Could Christ Jesus? No. He not only died for us, he rose from the dead, and there at God's right hand, he stands and pleads for us. Nothing therefore can come between us and the love of Christ. Even if we are troubled or worried or being persecuted or lacking food or clothes or being threatened or even attacked, these are the trials through which we triumph by the power of him who loved us. For I am certain of this, neither death, nor life, nor angel, nor prince, nothing that exists, nothing still to come, not any power or height or depth or any created things can ever come between us that love of death or any created God made visible in Christ Jesus our Lord. The word of the Lord.
Disciples, when the Son of Man comes in his glory and all the angels with him, he will sit upon his glorious throne, and all the nations will be assembled before him, and he will separate them one from another as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. He will place the sheep on his right and the goats on his left. Then the king will say to those on his right, come, you who are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I am hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me drink. A stranger, and you welcomed me. Naked, and you clothed me. Ill, and you cared for me. In prison, and you visited me. Then the righteous will answer him and say, Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you drink? When did we see you a stranger and welcome you, or naked and clothe you? When did we see you ill or in prison and we visit you? And the king will say to them in reply, Amen, I say to you, whatever you did for one of these least brothers of mine, you did it for me. Then he will say to those on his left, Depart from me, you accursed, into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry, and you gave me no food. I was thirsty, and you gave me no drink. A stranger, and you gave me no welcome. Naked, and you gave me no clothing. Ill, and in prison, and you did not care for me. Then they will answer and say, Lord, when did we see you hungry or thirsty, or a stranger, or naked, or ill, or in prison, and not minister to your needs? He will answer them, Amen, I say to you, what you did not do for one of these least ones, you did not do for me. And these will go up to eternal punishment, but the righteous to eternal life. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
We, as a parish, praying God to comfort and console you, wipe away your tears, and fill you with the peace of His ever-abiding presence. Jesus tells us what will happen at the end of our life. It is certain that we will all leave this world at the end of our life, after death, there will be judgment. I cannot judge, I'm not qualified. You cannot judge because you are not qualified. The one who qualifies, He is the Son of Man, Jesus, as we heard in the Gospel. Sometimes we find ourselves judging and condemning others. That is not our role. It is not our duty to judge and condemn others. That is the duty of God. Why? Because you are not qualified. For us to qualify to judge competently, we have to be men and women of impeccable character and absolute integrity. You and I are not impeccable. You and I make mistakes. So we are not impeccable. Only God is impeccable. And only God is absolute in integrity. And so Jesus made it very clear that when you appear before him, he will separate them, those who appear before him, like a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. The world is over the people, and thousands of people die every day. If the church teaches, the word of God teaches, that there will be judgment. We shall all give account of how we live our lives. That on that day, those on the right hand side, the sheep, he will say to them, come and inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. When I was hungry, you gave me food. When I was thirsty, you gave me drink. When I was a stranger, you welcomed me. When I was naked, you clothed me. When I was sick, you cared for me. And when I was in prison, you visited me. I may want to ask, did we care for our sister? I've observed that in many cases that people care only when someone is dead. But when the person is alive, they don't care a hoot. But when the person dies, they dress up decently and come to the funeral. She has gone. She will not appreciate this. She would rather appreciate those who visited her when she was in need. The time she was sick, the time she was in distress, the time she needed the care of people. When I was sick, you visited me. If you visit her when she was sick, then you have done that for Jesus. And they will say, where did we see you, Lord? Hungry, thirsty, a stranger, naked, or sick, or in prison, and minister to you? And they will say to them,
just as you care for your brothers and sisters, the least of the brothers and sisters, you have cared for me. And they come and inherit the kingdom of heaven prepared for you. Those are the people on the right hand side, the sheep. And then those on the left hand side, he will say the same thing to them. When I was hungry, you never gave me food. When I was thirsty, you refused to give me drink. When I was a stranger, you never welcomed me. When I was sick, you never cared for me. When I was naked, you never clothed me. When I was in prison, you never visited me. And they in turn will ask, when, Lord, did we see you in all this condition? And he said, just as you failed to do that to the least of your brothers and sisters, you have failed to do that for me. Depart and be thrown into the eternal burning fire prepared for the devil and his courts. With that, Jesus is teaching us that there is heaven for those who live righteous life. And there is hell
for those who chose not to live a righteous life. We are to listen to Jesus. It is not the message for our sister. Our sister has gone. We don't know how she lived her life in Christ. If she did all that Jesus said, great, she will receive her reward. You and I, who are listening now, get the message of Jesus that we have to care for our brothers and sisters now that we are alive. After death, there will be no repentance. It will become too late. For all those who listen to Jesus, in the second reading, we are told that nothing will ever separate them from God. Not even persecution, not even hunger, not even death can separate them from the love of God. For having loved their neighbors, having loved their brothers and sisters who are in need, they have demonstrated that love for God, and they will receive their eternal reward. In our world today, full of trials and temptations and challenges, we have to pray. Pray to God to give you the grace to live practical Christianity. That's what Jesus is teaching us, practical Christianity. It is not enough to say, I am a Christian, and then you don't care for your brothers and sisters. You don't care for your mother, you don't care for your father. You don't care for your needy friends, your needy neighbors. If you are a true Christian, a child of God, then you must care. You must be practical in your love and care for all this. But because of the distractions in the world, we have to pray. Pray for the grace of God to be able to live the life worthy of God's children, the life of love. God has loved us so much. We also have to witness to God's love in the life of everyone we meet. And we have to pray God to open our hearts and mind and ears to hear His word and put them into practice, so that at the end of our life, we may not have cause to regret. We will rejoice eternally in the kingdom that Jesus Christ has won for us by His death on the cross, His shedding of His blood, and His resurrection. God wants all of us to be saved. No one to perish except those who chose to. Except those who chose to act like goats. Goats on the left hand side, Jesus said, sheep on the right hand side. You know, when you see a sheep, the sheep keep moving. Even when it's on the road, even when you hunt for the sheep, it doesn't even care. It just keep going on its own. Sheep acts like a sheep. I mean, like a fool. When you see somebody behave sheepishly, you see somebody behave like a sheep, I mean like a fool. If we are to live authentic and practical Christianity, when we show that practical love and care, people will think that we are foolish. People will think that we are stupid. We are not to be discouraged. But for those on the left-hand side who act like goats, they hear the word of God, but they will not listen, they will not act. You know, like goats, if you keep yam or corn and goat is coming to eat it, you say, child, the goat moves away. The moment you turn your back, the goat comes back again. Obstinacy and stubbornness. We are not to be stubborn. We are to be obedient to the word of God. The word of God tells us in Psalm 95, if today you have heard His voice, you have heard the word of God, do not harden your hearts. Amen.
Family members with prayers, please come up.
Brothers and sisters, Jesus Christ is risen from the dead and sits at the right hand of the Father, where he intercedes for his church, confident that God hears the voice of those who trust in the Lord Jesus Christ. We join our prayers to his.
The priest. Heavenly Father, grant that our priests be strengthened and healed by the power of the Eucharist they celebrate. May the word they proclaim give them courage and wisdom. We pray that all those whom they seek to serve may see in them the love and care of Jesus, our eternal High Priest, who is Lord forever and ever. We pray to the Lord. Prayer for the church. Dear Lord Jesus Christ, we approach you today with sincere, affectionate, and tranquil hearts. We pray for the Holy Church across the world that may endure and prevail over the influence of the underworld. O Lord, as we have proclaimed the harvest in plentiful, but the workers are few, may your assumption motivate us to encourage our children to embrace their calling to serve through the holy orders. We pray to you.
Prayer for the world. Heavenly Father, we pray that all people who have one marker and father may acknowledge one another as brothers and sisters with discrimination of race or nation, and this sincere heart seek the kingdom of God, which is peace and joy. We ask you, help this world to know what is wrong and what is right. Provide peace and hope to those who are suffering from injustice. Show them that you are there and you care for them, and that you will make all things right. God, I pray for a world full of love and compassion. We pray to the world.
Prayer for the sick. God of all goodness, look with mercy on all who suffer any kind of infirmity, sickness, or injury, that they may be comforted. Let your hand of healing and protection be upon them. When they are fearful, ease their fear and anxieties. When they are afraid, give them strength and courage. When they feel alone, send them someone to listen and to care. When they are confused, provide reassurance and direction. When they are in pain, ease their suffering. When they despair, give them hope. We ask this in your holy name. We pray to the Lord.
Prayer for the departed souls. Lord Jesus, holy and compassionate, forgive your people their sins. By dying, you unlock the gates of life for those who believe in you. Do not let your people be parted from you, but by your glorious power, give them light, joy, and peace in heaven, where you live and reign forever and ever. Pray to the Lord.
We pray for the family and friends of her sister, Cyrenia, that they may be consoled in their grief by the Lord. That the Lord God Almighty will wipe away their tears, heal their pain, and dispel the darkness of doubt that comes with grief, and fill them with the peace of his ever abiding divine presence. For this we pray to the Lord. We pray for all of us gathered here in faith and confident to pray for our sister Cyrenia, strengthen our hope that we may live in the expectation of your son's coming and live lives worthy of our calling as Christians, worthy of God's children, and be worthy of eternal salvation Jesus Christ has won for us. For this we pray to the Lord. Lord God Almighty, giver of peace and healer of souls, hear the prayers of the Redeemer, Jesus Christ, and the voices of your people, whose lives were purchased by the blood of the Lamb. Forgive the sins of all who sleep in Christ, and grant them a place in your heavenly kingdom. We make all our prayers through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Please be seated. We shall now take up a collection, and we are asking you to be generous in your giving. It is for the upkeep of the cemetery. As we do so, let us all join in singing, "Try a Little Kindness."
If you see your sister standing by the road,
if a heavy load from the city soul, and if you see your sister falling by the way, just stop and say, "I'm going your way."
You got to try a little kindness, just show a little blindness, just shine a light for everyone to see.
We shall now have the signing of the register, and we ask the four name witnesses on the leaflet. Please join Father at the table for the signing of the register. During this time, we listen to a special rendition. Is the person for the special present? The person for the special rendition, are you present?
Before we depart and go our separate ways, let us take leave of our sister. May our farewell express affection for her. May it ease our sadness and strengthen our hope. One day we shall joyfully greet her again, when the love of Christ, we conquers all things, destroys even death itself.
Together, let us join in singing. Church.
Saints of God, come to aid. Hasten to meet the angels of the Lord. Receive a soul and present her to God the Most High. May Christ, who called you, take you to himself. The angels lead you to the bosom of Abraham. Receive her soul and present her to God the Most High. Eternal rest grant unto her, O Lord, and let perpetual light shine upon her. Receive her soul and present her to God the Most High. Prayer of commendation. Into your hands, Father of mercy, we commend our sisters, Cyrenia, in the sure and certain hope that together with all who have died in Christ, she will rise with him on the last day. Merciful Lord, turn towards us and listen to our prayers. Open the gates of paradise to your servants and help us who remain to comfort one another with assurances of faith until we all meet in Christ and are with you and with our sister forever. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Whoever believes in me, even though that person dies, shall live. I am the resurrection and the life, says the Lord. Whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. May the soul of Cyrenia and the souls of all the faithful departed, through the mercy of God, rest in peace. Amen. Amen. May their souls rest in perfect peace. Amen. Amen.
Nous voulons remercier tout le monde qui attendait l'étonnement après-midi, qui venait supporter la famille. Yo kado merci, merci en pile. Yo ni jeune maman, so yo kamado pour continuer prédier. Bay ces maman là pour yo sa comprendre. La mort est pour accepter ki yo pa ni maman encore et pour yo conduire ko yo bien comme il faut. We say a special thank you to our deacon, Deacon Everistus, and our priest, Father Henry. Thank you, choir members and animator and musician. As we take our sister's body, it will be cremated. Our brother Ricardo, with our assistance, will do for us "People Like You," our departing song.
Yeah, 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 oh, yes. If you give a little more than you take, and if you try to fix more than you break, if you're the kind who takes the time to help a stranger in the rain, there's a place for people like you. If you stand up for those down on their knees and lend a voice to those who cannot speak, if you shine a little light and give sight to the ones who've lost the way, there's a place for people like you. I've heard up there the streets are made of gold, and when you get there, there's a hand to hold. I believe when your days down here are through, there's a place up there for people like you. If you walk around with your heart on a sleeve, and if you try to be the change you want to see, if you laid down your life for someone, someone could be saved. There's a place up there for people like you. I've heard up there the streets are made of gold. And when you get there, there's a hand to hold. Now I believe when your days down here are through, there's a place up there for people like you. I've heard up there the streets are made of gold. And when you get there, there's a hand to hold. I believe when your days down here are through, there's a place up there for people like you. I know you're out there, so keep doing what you do. There's a place up there for people like you. There's a place up there for people like you. There's a place up there for people like you.